Everything working? All right, looks like we're go. All right, so you hopefully have realized that this is it before the exam on Wednesday. So we will work our way through the adaptive immunity and we'll see how we feel after that. And then you have the handout for chapter 5, and you'll see it's not a long chapter. So if I have, I would love to have had from 9 to 9:50 for just one. So I won't, we'll try to, wherever we are at the end of the day, that is it. So that's where it cuts off. You will be getting a practice quiz, study quiz. You can call it study quiz, study exam. That will be posted soon, hopefully at the end of the day. I'll have it done. And then it'll be posted for you to start practicing. So I know you're like, that's great. Thank you for ruining my Labor Day holiday. But it is, the test is not till Wednesday. So, but it is very, very, very beneficial for you to go through that practice quiz. It will be full, be random. So each time you take it, you should see different questions. So you're not going to get a feel for all the questions all at once. It'll be, hopefully it'll be up to 50. I don't know yet, but I think it will be. And then it'll be a something you can study with and see how the material is going to be asked on the exam Wednesday. Okay, so Wednesday is the exam. It'll open. I'll give you, probably won't open it till probably early Tuesday, because I don't want you to have issues like, oh, I opened up the test and where are you, Mr. Rector? I'm trying to do this and I'm panicking and something's happened. And but we'll give you plenty. That'll be 2 full days. So early Tuesday morning, it'll open. And then it'll close at the end of day Wednesday. So that'll give you either Tuesday night or Wednesday night or whenever you want to do it, it'll be there. So now it'll give you, you can practice, you can wait till Monday night and start practicing, or you can practice Tuesday night and take it Wednesday, whatever way's best. Most students, since I've learned, is if I open it up for 10 days, 99% of the students take it on day 10. Okay, so it doesn't really help for me to open it that long. The practice quiz, so you know it is over and over and over, and you get your highest grade, counts as your participation grade, it calculates that way. The exam is not over and over and over. Let me say that one more time. The exam is not over and over and over, okay? So your first completed attempt of the exam is your grade. Whatever that looks like, can't help it. That's it. You can call me and say, I was just practicing. I didn't know I was really in it. I didn't know. I thought I got so used to taking that practice quiz over and over. I just thought I'd take a sneak peek at the exam and see what it looked like. And then I locked, all those I've heard, this past year when we started doing the respondents in the spring. But don't get caught, that first, boom, Now, if it is set where if you go in and you lose connection because all of a sudden, suddenly decides that your internet's not worthy and it cuts you off and you drop, you can definitely get back in, okay? But I see those attempts. So if I see you attempted 5-minute intervals for 20 times, that's gonna red flag me that you're getting in there and looking at some questions and then coming out and going back. So make sure you're ready to start it. So now I do that for your benefit so that you do not start panicking that you just lost your grade and your grade posted as a 5. Got 5%, you got one question right? Yay. But I only took 2 questions before it logged me off. Okay, so we'll learn together, but that's the way it is. And I think you know how to get ready for this. I don't think it's any surprise. And the test shouldn't be any surprise. You should never be surprised by a test, okay? So you have the summaries at the end of the chapters. Those that are in micro know you've been getting study guides with the lecture. These summaries in these chapters are your study guide. Okay, so this is the info. So you key in on those, you study over those, make sure you understand those, the summaries. There's questions. I'm planning to get these loaded in so that these are part, the quiz. Okay, so these study questions that you have at the end of each chapter. So if you're like, I don't really want to do these, or I've already done them in my book, you're going to see them in the practice quiz, so they'll be part of the pool. So part of the job of setting up pools is to get these questions loaded in to the regular questions that we have and board questions that we have over this material. So that, you know, and you look at it, chapter 4 is 18 questions reviewed. And that's pretty normal, about 18 for each chapter, so you can see how it's going to build pretty quick. And then you get a 50-question exam, so each question is worth 2 on Wednesday. All right. So you may not see all these again. You may see 1 or 2. You may see none. I don't know how it randomizes. I don't know. All right. So we can't just go over, hey, here's 50 questions. We'll go over the right answers at the end of the day, and you'll know how your test went. But you'll know. You'll know your score when you're complete the exam. Any questions about that at all, about exam and how it's going to go? Hopefully you don't have any other exams, okay? I didn't bring the other practice set of questions today. We'll wait and get that on Wednesday. Okay, I didn't want you to be distracted by dilutions and working on those. And if you've seen grades posting, I know sometimes I forget to ask to take up handouts, but if you haven't turned in your pipetting exercise and you have it, if you'll just leave it today, it'd be great. And I'll go grade it this afternoon. So when you have things, make sure you give them to me, even if I don't call on them and to pick them up, because we're putting those grades in Blackboard for your participation and attendance. Okay. All right. Questions from Zoom land before we go. So the choice here is the adaptive immunity. And if we get to the antibody descriptions in chapter 5, great. If we don't, you know, we'll cut it off wherever we are, okay? If I feel like we can't get through chapter 5, it's 5 minutes, 10 minutes, whatever it is, we'll cut this exam. So I said the exam dates would stay solid because you make plans around exam dates, but the material may flux. So we might have just 1 through 4 instead of 1 through 5. We'll pick up 5, we'll pick up in exam 2. So depending on how we pace that, we may be able to catch back up. We may not. We may just be a chapter behind. But I do want to try to, I know some of you are like, he better stay on the schedule, right? I know some of you are like that. The others are like, he better not put anything on there that he hadn't talked about yet, right? All right, let's go. T-cell differentiation, the double positive stage. This is the kind of review we talked about this. The thymocyte expresses CD4 and CD8. And it rearranges the gene coding of the alpha chain. Remember we said there was alpha and beta chain. So there is positive selection for functional T cell receptors. That's what that does. So the T cell receptors are on the T cell, and it has a chance to show that it has those receptors. And once it shows those receptors, it's clear to go on to keep maturing. Major histocompatibility restriction, only cells that react with host major histocompatibility survive. So only the MHC ones and two reactions is what holds the cell together. If they don't have that, they are done away with before they get a chance to continue. Negative selection, cells that react with self-antigens are destroyed. So here's the positive selection. You'll see that on the question. And they have a negative selection where if they're too aggressive with self-antigens, the body eliminates them, okay? So is this a potential part of autoimmunity? Could be, right? This could be the hiccup. We get down here and we're not getting enough negative selection. Something gets passed, something gets through, and it goes out and starts causing harm. The survivors, of the positive and negative selection. Now either exhibit one or the other. They become the CD4 helper or they become the CD8 cytotoxic. The CD4 T cells are called helper cells and they assist their function. How you would classify this. Function of a helper cell is to assist in antibody production. And we're going to see that as we continue through the chapter. CD8, the cytotoxic T cell, its function is to kill target cells. Okay. Well, that target cell could be a virally infected cell. It picks up, comes in, cytotoxic, cell killer, and it does away with it. So this is from your text. Are y'all liking the text? Have y'all been like diving into this? Is it easy to get through, read through? Who hadn't opened their book yet? Is that a good question to ask like 2 weeks in or is it too soon to ask that question? Okay. Y'all aren't in a good mood. And this, what happened first period? You know, this Friday, right? And y'all look like you've been, anyway. Friday before the test. I guess that's what's got you worried. T cell differentiation. So here's the T helper cell, right? The CD4, okay? So it comes in, this is the T cell receptor. So this is our lymphocyte here. Okay, and we said this is the antigen presenting cell, presenting, and we made the distinction what? Oh my little guy, stuff popping up. I guess I'm getting too close to the board. So what was it again? Who's associated with who? Tells you right here, right? T helpers are associated with class 2. So that means the CD8, the cytotoxic, is associated with who? Class 1. Got it. You have to get, if you don't get anything else out of this chapter, that's what I need you to get. So you see here that you have a CD4 receptor, right? And here's the MHC2 molecule on the antigen-presenting cell, and it's a self-antigen, so that's not good, right? So if they bind here, they're going to be destroyed, right? Apoptosis. If they come in and they get to the macrophage or the dendritic, the antigen-presenting cell, right? And there's no binding to self-antigen, so this just illustrates us that now we can move on out of the thymus and go do our thing. Okay, so this is the 2/3 of the peripheral T cells is the T helper cell. So when we see a lymphocyte in our blood smear, we can say that 2/3 of that count that we make is T helper. So this is a side-by-side comparison of T helpers. Okay, so we're still in T helper and we have T helper 1s and T helper 2s. Okay, so there's different classes of the T helper. The T helper 1 produces interferon gamma, interleukin 2, tumor necrosis factor. Okay, so we kind of hinted to these, but we hadn't really dived in and gotten really deep, so we're starting to get into some of these interleukins. So T helper 2 produces a whole list, 4, 5, 6, 9, 10, and 13. All right, does anybody know which IL is most important right now to us? Anybody been following COVID? No. It's 6. Okay, IL-6 is definitely the reason, we can measure it, and it's also is telling us how sick the patient is going to become. So it's the best indicator that the doctors have as to who's going to end up in the ICU. So what they do is they come in, just like they would with a sepsis protocol, they come in and they get a list of tests done. They come into the hospital. And then of those tests, they monitor IL-6 and see what it's doing. If it starts to bump up and double and triple, then they know that patient's going to probably end, that needs aggressive treatment, okay? Which means they need to take care of that patient a little bit more than all the others, or they're going to end up on a vent.
Did I hear you say bonus question?
Did I hear bonus question?
Yes.
you know, I'm not too big on it. Did I ever get bonus questions? I don't remember bonus questions.
Well, I don't know, but you know,
I think you should.
I do bonus assignments. That's what I like to do. You know, like, hey, here's a chance for you to gain a little, you know, makeup, right?
Well, when is principals?
Hmm?
Like, is it, it's not Monday.
I don't like another one.
What about principals? Oh, when you go help? Oh, yeah. Yeah, you get that, but I'm talking about a good assignment. Like, you should see my YouTube channel. Y'all seen, y'all like to follow YouTube channels?
YouTube channel.
Well, I have my own, and then I have an A-State Micro YouTube channel that I created over the quarantine hearing.
What do you do?
Well, some of the students, one of the assignments for Micro 2 and for Paris Collin,
Yeah, I didn't do it.
Yeah, the assignment was to be the expert and talk about COVID-19. Back in April, okay, so they videoed their presentations and sent them to me, and a few of them have given me the okay to post. So they're on the A-State Micro YouTube channel. You have to watch it on your own. We got them.
Well, yeah.
You're trying to just, jack the box. All right, but I have my own YouTube channel too, and that'd be under my name, and that's where I post my, we say concert
videos.
Concert videos. The concerts I've had that my daughter has dragged me to. So I like to do the Facebook Live while I'm at the concert, you know, so you can hear the song and then I post. But nobody watches
it.
Nobody watches it. My daughter has dragged me to Nile Horan. Which was very good. Marin, what's her name? Marin, somebody in the middle. That song, I heard it like 1,000 times. Marin, I don't know what. Anyway, they were together at Fayetteville. We went up to Fayetteville or Benton, whatever, Rogers, wherever that outside thing was. And then that same summer, we went to see Harry Styles. So it performed. I took her to that. So I've got those recordings if you want to listen to those songs. I posted a few of my live videos. So yeah. All
right.
Yes, One Direction, yeah. She's waiting on the reunion. She keeps thinking they're going to get a reunion. Yeah. I promised her I'd take her to the reunion if we have concerts anymore. Yeah, but back to IL-6. IL-6 is an interleukin that plays part of this. These are the cytokines, and those are coming. Okay, we're going to get to the cytokines, and we're going to cover all these. So right now, it's just kind of see that these are being produced. You could put them in the class of one, but interferon gamma does some things, interleukin. You don't know what those do yet, so we're getting there. The T helper here helps B cells produce antibodies, and it also regulates B cell activity. So that's very important to the adaptive immunity. And the T helper 1 activates two cytotoxic lymphocytes and macrophages. Well, you know, we kind of know who cytotoxic. So the helper cells kind of orchestrate or quarterback or make the whole immune system, the adaptive immune system, kind of go. Okay. So back in the early 80s, I know that's way before your time, but I was in high school when HIV was discovered, okay? Kind of like you were in college when COVID was discovered, right? So HIV was discovered when I was in high school, and HIV has a real tendency to go after these, okay? It likes to set up and destroy those helper cells, all right? Like I said, viruses seem to have a computer program that, like, how can I make sure I survive? I know, I'll just go after one particular cell in the body, a T helper cell, and knock it out. Doesn't go after the others, it doesn't set up in the others, it goes after T helpers and takes out basically the quarterback of the whole show. So then your immune system struggles, and then you go down in immunity, and then all these weird things start to infect the HIV patient. And they die from that. They die from having all the other things. So we see that this plays a key role, and we're going to talk about HIV later in the semester. But it is one of those viruses that knows kind of what's going on with the immune system and messes it up. We have other T helpers, other subpopulations. We have one that's really important, Treg. I mean, it regulates, right? It regulates the activity. It suppresses the immune response to self-antigens. Again, is there something here that's amiss with autoimmunity? Could be. Secretes inhibitory cytokines, which inhibit the proliferation of other T cell populations. So basically, let's pull it back. Yeah, we know it was, we needed you for a little bit, but you've done enough and we need to shut you down before you destroy the body, right? That's what Treg do. You know, they got to slow down the immune response. So again, we got to throw COVID in here. So this was the big story a few weeks ago. Man, it seems like a few weeks ago. It's probably been longer. But the cytokine storm, I don't know if you heard that term. The immune system is overwhelming the body. It's the response that people are having to this virus that's killing the people. So, had you scared to death that, oh my gosh, if I got a really good immune system, what's going to happen? I'm going to go into this cytokine storm and I'm going to end up on a vent, right? So this has all been talked about in the last few months that if you're paying attention, it should be in your wheelhouse about immunology, testing, and what the patient's going through, all of that. So I took that and assigned it to the students to talk about and say, y'all, you be the expert. You be the person they put the mic in front of and say, tell us about the immune system. Who better, right? Who better? You guys are having a whole class on immunology. So you're going to know it, right? You're going to be able to take that mic and say, I know all about the immune system. And this is what's going on. And this is probably the problem. And we're not hearing that because I think some of the people that have got the mic in front of them are not immunologists. They don't know. They don't know the activities that they can kind of guess and they kind of say, but they don't sound really good about knowing everything that's going on. So I like this. This is the subset of T helper. You see, we got T helper 1, we got the T reg down here, we got the T helper 2, we got a subset of 17 and 9 down here. And you're going to see how this plays. So here is our, let's say we have an extracellular pathogen or a parasite is in the body. Okay, it's invaded the body. It can be bacteria, it can be viruses, it can be fungi. Okay, so what we have is the macrophage here engulfing it, right? And then you see all these things starting to show up. We got IL-6 right there. We got growth factor beta, IL-4. We got IL-4 again. We got polarizing cytokines. We have a naive CD4 helper cell right here. So it's just being bombarded, all right, from what? Antigen presentation, whether it be the granule, neutrophil, monocyte, dendritic, whoever's up here taking care of the pathogen as it comes in is now signaling for help. Okay, here it is. I just grabbed an antigen. Before it gets in the body so far, we need some help from you, T4. T4 differentiates into the other T helper cell line. So this is naive, meaning it can be whichever one it needs to be. And they differentiate into the subpopulations. And you see interferon gamma down here, growth factor beta, IL-17, IL-9, IL-4. We're going to go through these interleukins and get a better idea of what's going on. But as you see, T helper 1, cell mediated immunity and inflammation. T cell 2, right, with B cells and antibody production, humoral immunity. So when we go back, that's a real confusing slide, right? It's very detailed. But when we go back to this now, and this makes better sense, right? T helper one, down here with cytotoxics, the macrophages, and T helper two on the other side over here, talking about the B cells and the antibodies, okay? Making sense? So that subset of T helper has a role where you see it's cytotoxic and T cell macrophages over here, influencing them, cell-mediated immunity, inflammation, and then over here, the T helper two is the B cell, humoral immunity, the antibody production. Got it? Remember that. Remember that division between the two helpers.
Could we associate like the N2 with the IL-4, IL-5, and IL-13?
Not yet.
I can't see.
Not yet. Okay. I mean, do I need you to know those? No. Just know there are some cytokines that are going to influence this differentiation subset. Yeah, we're not there yet.
It's coming. We will be eventually.
Yeah, it's chapter 6.
Sorry. Oh.
All right, it's coming probably, Friday, next Friday, a week from today, you'll start it. And I don't know how long we're going to stay in that chapter. We might stay a couple of days. Because it's that important to me, I think, that you know these cytokines. B cells. Yay. B cells. All right? So we know that the B cell is going to do what? What does the B cell do that the T cell doesn't? In maturation. They both start off where? Let's simplify it. Easy enough, right? Where do they start off? Both are in the bone marrow. One of them leaves the bone marrow and does to do its maturing, and it ends up in the thymus, right? That was the first question I gave you. So now you know. So there's no question. You'll never miss that question. I'm confident you'll never miss that question when I ask you where T cells start off, okay? B cells start off in the bone marrow, and they stay there, okay? They stay there and mature. They mature into who they want to be, and then they come out and they end up going to search the body and wait, right? They wait for Andy. Okay, so we get the hemo, and is that, I think I saw the top of y'all's, hang on, was that what y'all were in today? Are y'all here yet, hematology? Y'all in white cells yet? Where are y'all? Still red cells?
Yeah, hematocrit and then
we're like a lecture from them.
Okay. Yeah. Maybe. What are your lecture behind here, too? Y'all want to come in Monday and catch up?
Yeah.
No. Zoom, y'all want to come in Monday and catch up?
Man, I'm probably going to get
bonus?
Getting on Zoom at home.
For bonus points.
It's a holiday. The curse in the bone marrow. That's where the B cell differentiation occurs. That hematopoietic stem cell develops into the early lymphocyte progenitor. Remember, B cells are lymphocytes. Don't forget that. I know we've been like swatting you with T cells since this lecture got presented 3 days ago, it seemed like. So what's involved? Development of mature immunocompetent B cells, okay? Activation of the B cell by the antigen, and differentiation of the activated B cell into the antibody-producing plasma cell. Now that last statement, all right, it's my time to confuse you because it's confused people before. That's almost interchangeable on exams. Some exam writers will just, it's a B cell, they'll say B cells produce antibodies, okay? And that's practically right, right? But you're going to know more. You're going to know that the B cell is the cell that eventually produces antibody, right? But don't get confused on a test when they throw the B cell up there. And then when they put out the plasma cell, okay? One in the same. Plasma cell is just a continued maturation of an activated B cell that's getting ready to spit out some immunoglobulin. Okay, antibody. So don't let that be your hurdle. Don't think that's two different. I mean, it is. It's two different. It all came from the first cell. It basically came from here, right? Comes from the very first one, right? We can say this B cell matures all the way into a plasma cell if it's needed. But not all B cells are going to end up plasma cells, okay? They have to get to that point to spit out immunoglobulin. So here it is. This is our B cell differentiation. Antigen independent phase, that's key, right? Because the B cell has not been presented with an antigen yet. And we know each antibody that a B cell produces eventually through the plasma cell is specific for one antigen, right? They make one for one. Keep that in mind. So we start off with the stem cell. Where is this again? Where are we? Zoom, where are we? I guess Lauren's the only one that will talk through Zoom. Are y'all there?
I'm here. Sorry, cut out.
Where's this stem cell? Where are we right here in the body?
My screen is currently not pulling up.
Oh, it's not?
I don't think it's... For everybody, my computer is just completely glitched right now. I'm trying.
Okay, but I am sharing it, right?
Yeah, you're sharing it. I'm just waiting for it to load.
Okay. Well, I've got 18 in here that can tell us, or not 18. I mean, you're 13 in here. Where is that stem cell? Bone marrow, right?
Yeah.
Bone marrow is where this is happening. So we get a pro B cell going to a pre B cell. Going to an immature B cell, and then we come out of the bone marrow, right? And this is where we'll get into the spleen and the lymph nodes. That's our lymphoid tissue that we started the very first day. We talked about where these cells would find the antigens once they were ready to go. So we have this pro B cell that has a bone marrow stromal cell connected. And then we see something in the pre. And the pre has an alpha and beta pop up. It has some mu chains here inside. And it has the mu and the surrogate light chains. It starts to form what? It starts to put an antibody out of its cell. You know? So I don't know if you've ever thought about antibodies, but some of you might think, well, there are attached antibodies. Yes, they're attached to the cell to begin with. Okay? So this is the B cell that's going to now move, still here, right? And it has an IgM out here. And I'll move my participation key down there so you can see the bottom. Move it over there. How about that? All right. So it moves out. So you see that it has self-antigens give negative signals, and if it picks up a self-antigen binding to the antibody here, this is an IgM antibody, okay? The reason that's fun and the reason we're not going to make it into the other chapter, that's going to be all the different types of antibodies, right? And you're probably thinking, well, when we saw IgM the last time, have y'all ever seen IgM before in any lecture?
IgG.
IgG, where do you see IgG? Here?
Micro.
No, before, in micro?
No.
Like any other lecture anywhere else in your whole, like, prep before you got here today. Have you ever heard of IgM or seen IgM?
Yeah,
okay. Well, just to give you a preview, it usually looks by itself, it usually has five. It usually has five separate immunoglobulins connected. So it's called a pentamer. Okay, so the IgM becomes huge. Right, and it has a chance to bind 10 different things. Right, it's got what we call five forks. Okay, if you want to think of it all wrapped together, and it rolls through your body, and it has like 10 chances to grab a hold of something. Manage. Okay, we'll get into that on next. next Wednesday. What are we going to do Wednesday? We're having a test Wednesday night. Did I say we would start lecture or not start lecture?
You said
we wouldn't have class. We wouldn't have class on
the
test day. Just need to make sure I've said that. So, yes, we're going to start the immunoglobulins on Friday. Okay, Friday will be a week from today when we get into chapter 5. You got the handout today. So, the test will, Zoom, if you're listening, the test will be 1 through 4. Okay, because we're at 9:35. I think we can get through chapter 4 pretty easy. But here, same thing, right? So this is happening in the bone marrow. Self-antigen, maturation. If the B cell is aggressive to the self-antigen, poof, it's taken care of, right? So we lose population of B cells for this. We lose population of T cells because of this. So this is the body's self-check, okay? Self-antigen negative signals. If it binds here, self-antigen, then it's destroyed. Okay, once it matures, right, remember this is the antigen-independent phase, so it hadn't seen an antigen yet. Okay, it comes out, and then it moves into the spleen and the lymph nodes, and look what happens. All of a sudden, we see somebody over here, we got an IgD show up, okay? And the reason I was asking about what you know about immunoglobulins, because IgD we don't even think about. But we do think about it here in B cell maturation. It shows up on the surface. Not only is the IgM there, the IgD is there. It's going to play a role you're going to see in just a minute. Over here, we see in the spleen, marginal zone, there's a B cell, and they remain in the spleen, waiting on what? Waiting on the antigen. Here we went to the lymph node, okay? We're in the follicular of the lymph node, and we're looking. We may even enter the circulation at this point. So, right? So we get B cells placed in the body. Haven't seen the antigen yet, okay? So the differentiation of the pro, they develop from rearrangement of their genes, from heavy to light chain. Made specific for certain antigens, right? So they're being made, but they hadn't seen. Most successful rearrangement, one set of heavy pro B cells. There's a heavy mu chain of IgM class. So that we saw that in our picture. They accumulate in the cytoplasm and they express out of the cell surface, right? All right, so the IgM is expressed at this point. Short chains of Ig alpha and Ig beta, and we saw those. All right, they were right here, alpha, beta. Mu chains are here. Here comes that mu and surrogate-like chains, and the IgM pokes out. So I'm just putting it where the words are. We have complete IgM antibody molecules on the cell surface, and that's our antigen receptor. Okay, so that IgM that's sticking out is looking for the antigen, or hits the antigen, or the antigen hits it. You know, we don't know. Have variable regions that determine specificity, and we also have a 21 and a 40 CD out there. And since this is a B cell, what is the MHC?
Class 2
molecules. So back to this, y'all remember alpha and beta? Subunits for MHC, right? Yes, y'all remember alpha and beta? When we went all the way back to the T cell and I said it's alpha and beta, and I think they were red and green on the picture, and it was one had a 3 and a 1 and the other had a 2-2. You remember those? The alpha and beta chains? All the way back? Yeah, y'all do? Y'all studied that already, right? The process of central tolerance involves elimination of those B cells that are self-reactive receptors. So if the immature B cell likes self-antigen, then we don't want that B cell. But if the B cell survives the central tolerance, they move on to the spleen. They develop in the spleen, and the marginal B cell remains in the spleen. They respond quickly to blood-borne pathogens, so that makes our blood just bright, clean, and good. Because if there's any pathogen that makes it to our bloodstream, we got B cells that see it. there's follicular B cells that migrate to lymph nodes, right? The other secondary organ, and those go back into recirculation. So that's our B cell setup. We got those out there. We're ready to go, waiting on some antigen to come around. It exhibits, this is key, this exhibits the mature B cell, exhibits IgM and IgD. Don't forget about IgD, okay? A lot of people do. Some people even forget about the IgM on the test, okay? Don't remember, they're both there. These surface immunoglobulins provide activating signal to the B cells when contacting with the antigen, when they contact the antigen. Once they're stimulated, they enter the antigen-dependent phase. And they become memory cells, and they become antibody-secreting plasma cells. Okay, so all of this was just to get back to where we kind of started, which was the plasma cell, right? Here is the plasma cell. So if you were looking at this on your smear and hematology, you would not call that a macrophage, please don't. Okay, but you see these vacuoles in there and you're like, oh, only the macrophage, only the monocyte has vacuoles, right? Sorry, I'm in the blood. Only the monocyte has vacuoles. Nothing else would have a vacuole like that. If it has vacuoles, I'm calling it a monocyte. You count it as a monocyte. But you disregard the color. You disregard the nucleus and you disregard the color of the cytoplasm. So how many smears, have y'all stained any smears yet? I think y'all have done that, right? Give you a word of advice. Never count anybody else's stain slide. Get used to staining your slide and counting your slide, because you'll have a unique way. Somebody else may stain and every cell's red. Somebody else may stain and every cell's purple, right? Or whatever. You count yours that you make, okay? It'll pay off. It's hard. Just put it that way. It's hard to take somebody else's staining when you're not used to their staining, to make calls on like this, okay? All right. They produce the antibodies. So this is a plasma B cell, differentiated, right? Ready to start spitting out some immunoglobulins. And that's our story, okay?
I have a question.
Yes.
So, for example, like on the test, if we had a question that says B cells produce plasma antibodies or the memory cells, all of these are correct.
You mean you say when we say B cells, yeah. Mature B cells, what could they be?
Yeah.
Memory cells, plasma producing cells, yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So all of them.
Yes. Those are your choices. All right, on page 53, you get a gray. I don't think I have this picture on the slideshow, but you can kind of see the immature, when it exits the bone marrow, it shows the IgMs on the surface. The mature B cell has the IgD and the IgM. You see the antigen there in those three little green dots. You see that that B cell picks up three of those antigens, so you see there's multiple IgMs on the surface. And then you see that turns into the plasma cell. So once the antigen gets taken up and gets shown to the B cell, then the B cell moves into its producing of the antibody that just bound that antigen. Does that make sense? So that antigen that bound to that B cell, now that B cell can turn into a plasma cell and make more of those antibodies that it had on its surface, same kind. And now that goes out into the circulation by themselves. And then we see a whole nother part of the adaptive immune system once those antibodies get out there, okay? So I think one of the things that's in your summary is that once we get this production of the antibodies, right? Is that at the beginning it's equal, and we won't spend a lot of time till next lecture about IgM and IgG, but chapter 5 was going to tell you about those classes. So when you see that plasma cell and memory cell, you don't know what those are yet, but those are IgM first, right? Then it's IgG. And if you've gone into chapter 5, that may sound familiar. If you hadn't, then you've got something to stay tuned for. The role of the T cell in the adaptive immune system, we're back to the T cell. antigen presenting, this is on page 53, starts there. Antigen presenters are activated during the innate immune response. T cells interact with antigen presenting cells to initiate the adaptive immune response. And then T cells circulate throughout the bloodstream, lymph nodes, and secondary lymphoid tissue looking for antigens. Okay, so that is their role in the adaptive immune system. Okay, so the action of the T helper, so we're back to the T helper. I think I can go back over here, get it off the slide. So here's our macrophage at the top. That's our antigen presenting cell. It's got bacterial antigens inside, and we see this is the T helper, right? So let me, I'm going to zoom, I'm covering up MHC class, whatever. And if it's a CD4, again, what class is it? Class 2 goes to CD4. Here's the class 2, the red and the green. T cell receptor here, T helper cell, and then it becomes activated. And you see the cytokines playing the role. Remember we said that macrophage is releasing all these cytokines. The T cell takes it up. The T cell has an interleukin 2 receptor. The cytokine binds to the activated T cell, and then the activated T cell starts to move into memory. It goes into clonal expansion. And in this clonal expansion, what those T cells do is start producing more cytokines, right? Releasing all the good stuff. And that affects our other cells and the adaptive neutrophil, macrophage, cytotoxic T cell, right? The CD8 and the B cell for antibody production. That kind of cleans, I think that finishes up the story of our adaptive immune system, bringing in how the T helper cell works, what it influences, how it's influenced, and the end result. Here's the action of the cytotoxic T cell. Remember, what MHC class is it that it binds to? One, yes. Here is the antigen presenting from the target cell that presented its antigen. Here's our T cytotoxic that binds to the antigen and the MHC class 1 molecule. Okay, and then we kind of talked about whether it's what? Endocytotic being inside the cell or exocytotic being outside the cell. And this one, as you see, right, here's our cytotoxic T cell coming in. And what it's doing is doing what? It is taking on the cell, the target cell is this blue here. It's releasing perforin and granzymes. All of that's going to start taking up that target cell membrane and leading to target cell death. So that cytotoxic T cell comes in, binds to a target cell presenting its antigen, and then destroys that cell. Okay? The role of B cells in the adaptive immune response to the T-dependent antigens. That's TD antigen, T-dependent. Okay, meaning what? The role of the B cell in the adaptive, meaning it has to be in, T cell has to be part of this. Okay, so here's the T helper. Here's the B cell. The B cell has its immunoglobulin here. Okay, so step one, got touch the antigen here. Okay, presents the antigen here, or the T cell presents the antigen. Looks like it's presenting together. They're binding together. The cytokines are influencing the B cell. The antigen binding of the B cell to the antigen. The B cell binding to the T helper cell antigen. All of that plays. All of these three things play to the response. Okay? So it could be all of them, one of them, whatever's happening. But that is dependent on a T cell getting in there. Right? Response to a T independent antigen would be you don't see any T cell, right? You just see a B cell binding that antigen right here. And then you see what? Toll-like receptor binding the antigen. Okay, and we talked about toll-like receptors being in the membrane of these lymphocytes. Why? Like day one, right? Of this chapter, the chapter before, I can't remember where these were, but toll-like receptors binding the antigen, just like the antibody binding the antigen. There's no T cell because it's T cell independent. All right, so finishing it up, how do we identify the lymphocytes? It helps us to diagnose cancers, immunodeficient diseases, and you're going to have some of those coming up. AIDS. We use cell flow cytometry. If y'all remember, you watched the first, were y'all in the first video when we showed the To Save a Life? You remember that one? And they talked about flow cytometry where they were able to see the genetic makeup of the cells by counting the cells that came through and all that good. Y'all remember that? That's what we're going to talk about, cell flow cytometry in here. It segregates the lymphocytes into subsets, and then we use a monoclonal antibody, which is not in this chapter. It's actually in chapter 5. So that's kind of coming later, monoclonals. And that's it. Okay, so you have your summary. I think we did good. We ended on chapter 4. The test will cover 1 through 4. So basically what my job is now is to go through and make sure my questions are all related to 1 through 4. Okay, we created a review exam and then give you a, get that up so you start practicing on that and get ready. Yeah.
You only teach this in the fall.
What's it?
You only teach this class in the fall?
Yes.
Okay, you remember when you had Evelyn and Shayla and all that?
Last fall, yeah.
Do you remember if their first exam was 1 through 4 or 1 through 5?
Different book.
I'm using their Quizlet.
You can use their Quizlet. It's over the same topics. It's just in a different format of presentation. So I would use their Quizlets to make you a set of Quizlets over these 4 chapters. Yeah, we changed books. I didn't like the book that they had, and it left a lot of this out. That's why we're in this book and going over this chapter like we just did. Because this was left out of that person. Their lectures, and when we got into it, it's like, we don't know what's up. Because they had missed all of this.
I'm sad under this mask.
So I made sure that we backed up. This book was I was more familiar with this text. I've used it for years. And I wanted this one, so we got it over.
So go through and see what pertains to this, and then
the topics have been rearranged. So look at theirs. If they have their syllabus, look at their syllabus. It's pretty much for this test, it's pretty close. And then I start flipping some out of like his. I think they had inflammatory way up here. I dropped that way down. So. There's certain things that they had early in their lectures. I looked at their old exam. They had a lot of that 5 was on their exam, their 1 exam. Some of this was, and then some stuff that we've moved, or I moved, sorry. So yeah, if you can hear this, do not rely on a exam 1 Quizlet, I'm going to sell you exam 1 from last year. You'll be fine. You won't be fine. Okay. But it's going to be, you need to focus on my review quiz that I'm posting. Okay. You need to focus. Everybody needs to focus.
Which, I mean, that's basically Quizlet anyways. So.
And work on these summaries. So you got 4 summaries to review. And then you got a review quiz to go along with it. Okay. If you have any questions, I do not check my email over when I'm not here. I'm not one of those professors. I do not have it go to my phone. I only, if you want me, text me. Okay. You can text me. I'll text your text all weekend long if you need
it. Your number's on the syllabus, then?
Number's on the syllabus. You can text me if you have questions. Facebook me if you need questions. Leave a comment in the YouTube video. I may not.
I'm trying to get that
answer. Yeah, just leave it. Yeah. You got your pipe cutting. I'll take it. Post your grades. Come on. Yes, white. Sorry. White.
You need to put ads on your YouTube. Then you make money.
I don't have enough viewers. I mean, it's terrible. I mean, I thought Harry Styles would bring me like.
You should make a TikTok. You can be the first.
I just knew he would.